Any objections?
Yeah.
You touch me and you won't live till morning.
You're not meeting them tomorrow.
Aren't I sweet?
Most of them turned out to be unhealthy. The farmer died from natural causes. The Swede and Blinky Franklin were both killed.
You know who else was in the gang?
You were.
Reach for that and I'll kick your brains out.
Hello, welcome to Movie Humpers. My name, Bob Sham.
My name, Angela.
The sounds of your may be dogs, they will be dogs.
There will be dogs. There are always dogs.
And it's the sound of dogs and us talking is what you will hear.
Yeah, if you don't hear us talking, then your volume's not on.
All month long is the left-hand endeavor. That is what we call our noir month. Every weekday this month, We're talking about noir. And we're at the ass end of week three, in which we're discussing a one that was made in 1946, directed by, see if I get this last name right.
Okay.
Robert Siodmak. S-I-O-D-M-A-K. Siodmak. This is The Killers. It's based upon a Ernest Hemingway book, and it's written by Anthony Veller, adapted from the Ernest Hemingway novel, starring Burt Lancaster, Ava Gardner, Edmund O'Brien, Albert Dekker, and Sam Levine. And yes, The Killers. The Killers. We got some killers in this movie, right?
There's a lot of killers in this movie.
I've been out of my cage and I've been doing just fine.
Yeah, if you look up this movie, you definitely have to type The Killers movie or you will scroll forever before you find it.
They remade this movie in 1964 with Lee Marvin, and it was Ronald Reagan's last role before he went into politics. And probably one of the few movies he made that wasn't, you know, mostly shat on. We have the Criterion version, which has both versions on there.
I have never seen a Ronald Reagan movie.
They're not popular. Like, He was in a lot of stuff, but, like, there's a famous picture of him with a chimp.
Okay.
Because he was in a movie with a chimp. It's too bad that guy didn't kill him when he shot him. Yeah, I said I don't give a fuck. The Killers!
The Killers!
Directed by Robert Siodmak. He did it for Jodie Foster, the guy that shot Reagan.
Oh, yes. For a second, I was like, what did Siodmak do for Jodie Foster? She was not even a twinkle in anyone's eye.
Yeah, Siodmak dedicated this to someone who wasn't born yet. Remember Jodie Foster in Taxi Driver?
Oh, yeah.
And Harvey Keitel's like, you just a little piece of chicken. She's just a little piece of chicken. Hey, we watched the Academy Awards.
We haven't talked about it.
I don't know when we is a good time to talk about it.
Whenever. Unless we're doing a dedicated episode. Then we could take 5 minutes.
Jimmy Kimmel, who's very mid in my opinion, overall.
Yeah.
Actually made a funny joke about how
in 1976, Jodie Foster is young enough to be Robert De Niro's daughter. Now she's 20 years too old to be his girlfriend.
Good old Bobby De Niro. Killers of the Flower Moon did not win shit, far as I know. But congratulations to Oppenheimer.
So many Oppenheimer awards.
Yeah. And Poor Things got all the design awards, and the sound award went to Zone of Interest, which was very well deserving.
Very well deserved. And big shout out to Best Supporting Actress from The Holdovers.
Yes. Divine Joy Randolph.
She was wonderful. And she looked beautiful.
Congratulations, Christopher Nolan and Oppenheimer and Emma Stone won for
Poor Things.
Yeah, that's her second Oscar. Yeah, it was fun. It wasn't as rough to sit through as I imagined. Although I would love to play a highlight from it because I got permission of from the Academy to a play a clip.
Oh.
And this is...
I didn't know you had asked anyone.
And I did. I got permission. They sent what they were like, this is the best clip from the Academy Awards.
Okay, okay.
Each art form maintains its individual characteristics. It's kind of like us, right? I mean, we do our own things. We also do our things together. We're like that Chippendale of showbiz. Right?
Chippendale.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't see us as the like or pant pelvic thrust types. Well, speak for yourself, but
What are you talking about? I said Chippendale.
You said Chippendales.
No, I'm saying, oh, no, I'm saying Chippendale. Chip in, comma, Dale, and you're saying Chippendales.
Oh, because I thought you were saying Chippendales. Chippendales.
Well, usually I am saying Chippendale, but not not now, because it's that would be weird.
Yeah. But why don't we just read what the brilliant writers wrote for us?
Oh, my God, look, there's a script on the thing.
And it has my name up there, look at
it. It's in yellow.
And there you go. That shit was good. Now let's talk about The Killers, directed by Robert Sedmak. These goons walk into a cafe and they're like, bright boy. Hey, bright boy, right? Mm-hmm. Bright boy, bright boy. They say it a lot.
They do.
Which one is yours?
Don't you remember, bright boy?
They're looking for someone, a fellow by the name of the Swede.
Yeah, Pete Lund is his name. But everyone calls him the Swede.
At least that was his name.
That's the name after these people ran away. In this town know him
yes,
by.
Yes, yes.
And there's another...
But he keeps his fucking nickname even when he's running away. Kind of not a good strategy.
Well, is it a nickname or is everyone being racist?
You mean, or ethnicist?
Yeah, whatever.
I guess, but...
Is everyone just being rude? Like...
When you're splitting hairs, though, it's not like you can tell what a Swede is from a Dutch or a fucking
I know. That's why it was
Englishman.
Actually weird. But I agree with you. It's weird that he was called the Swede in his old and new life. Seems like in the new life, he'd be like, don't ever call me that.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyway, there's the guy who owns the diner, the cook, and another guy is in the diner. And they basically take over the diner because they're waiting for Pete Lund to come in and have dinner. Because he comes in every day at 6 o'clock.
By 6 o'clock. But if he's not there by 6 and he's not
he
coming.
He ain't coming.
According to the cook. And these guys, they tie up the cook, the guy who runs the front, and a customer there.
They tie up the customer and the cook and then they let him go. And they truly say, you're very lucky. You should go play the lottery. Like, that they're not killing them. Because you really think, oh, these are like hitmen. You figure it out that they're there to kill this man and it's a job. But they have witnesses and they just walk away from these three people who've seen their faces. And they're very memorable. Mm-hmm. It's weird.
It's amazing all the criminals that we get this month that don't cover their faces.
Yeah.
It seemed like the dude from The Killing's the only one that was smart enough to... He put on the clown mask, you know?
You know, anyway. Eyewitness sketches have always been around.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
I mean, I know you could argue in some of these that maybe they didn't have fingerprints yet, but we're starting to. Like in these movies, they're starting to have fingerprints.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, not have fingerprints, but be able to trace them.
Humans did not get fingerprints until like 1925. When the customer is tied up, he knows the Swede. He happens to work with him. At wherever they
were. It's like a gas station.
Yeah, yeah. And so he runs up to his place and he's like warning them, but he's like laid out and it's like he's consigned to his fate.
Yeah, he basically says,
thanks for coming. Don't you want me to go and see the police? No. That wouldn't do any good. Isn't there something I could do? There ain't anything to do. Couldn't you get out of town? No. I'm through with all that running around.
Why do they want to kill you?
I did something wrong once. Thanks for coming.
Thank you for telling me, but I'm not going anywhere.
And we,
there's no point.
And that's when we see a close-up of his face. It's Burt Lancaster's dreamy eyes.
And he says, I did something bad once.
And then the following scene, the guys manage to figure out where he is, and they pop into the door, and they unload on him. So the movie's kind of like Citizen Kane-y, where the guy who works for the insurance, who's played
another insurance man,
who's played by Edmund O'Brien, is investigating the cause of the death of the Swede to determine whether they can pay out a $2,500 policy.
It feels as though, unless you've got something straight up like The Killing, not to be confused with The Killers, something like The Killing that's like a heist movie, most of these other noir films, there's either a private detective or an insurance man.
Yeah.
And it's always one of the two.
They might as well be the same thing.
But we haven't had an actual detective. There's always a friend who's a detective. No, I mean, I'm sorry, I meant like a police detective.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
They'll have friends who are working for the police force. Almost all of them have at least one. Even in this movie, there's someone that you kind of partner with.
Yeah. Burt Lancaster. What do you think of Burt Lancaster in terms of the hunko meter? Allegedly gay, probably bi.
I don't think he's that hunky.
I kind of like his overall look. He's got a soft look. He seems like a guy that could kind of be arranged because he is kind of...
Arranged?
Like he can provide, he can act and arrange, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because they do have him. He's like this kind of sensitive, soft kind of guy. Mm-hmm. And he has that look, but he's also like a boxer or whatever, right? So they kind of balance it out. But the character of the Swede... The saddest motherfucker probably all month long.
Oh, absolutely.
When it's all said and done, this guy got...
fucked over.
So bad.
You know, and you started to kind of lay out the way the story is told, and I love the way this story is told, because it is like Citizen Kane, like The Killing. A lot of these movies do start at the end and go back and tell you the story, but this one tells you the story in bits and pieces because it's... As the insurance man finds information, everyone he meets tells him a little bit more of the story to like fit the puzzle together. And the first person he talks to is the gas station guy.
Mm.
And, you know, that's where he finds out that, you know, he'd been working at the gas station for a while and that something bad had happened. But that's really all he knew. But he was like, there's something going on with this man.
The Swede's even sadder than Sherry's husband in The Killing, don't you think? Because at least he got his revenge on infidelity. At least he got a bullet in her ass.
I don't think the Swede
The Swede left this world with less than shit.
Yeah, but the Swede was dumb, because we'll talk about it. But none of this trajectory, none of it would have ever happened if he hadn't gone to jail for a woman. I mean, he got into trouble. He was not being a nice guy. But he didn't want a girl to go to jail, so he went to jail for her. Like... And that was the start of him being so sad.
But that makes the Swede worse than Alicia Cook.
I guess it does make him worse.
He's a total simp. It's total simp.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
You usually have to turn on an episode of 90 Day Fiancé to see simping this bad. When you simp this hard, simping ain't easy.
We learn immediately how sad he is when the insurance guy goes to this hotel that he stayed in for a while, because he left his insurance money, his life insurance money, to this woman that works in this hotel. And he goes there to give her the check, I guess. He hasn't given it to her yet. He goes to ask her. He basically is like, I'm trying to figure out what's going on with this man, but he left you this money. Do you know why? And she's like, I have no idea. But then she tells him this story about how she went into his room one night and he was ready to throw himself out the window. Like his room was like destroyed.
Mister, don't! Please, mister. Well, if you did, you'd never see the face of God. You'd burn in hell to the end of time. Oh, you mustn't, mister. Oh, bless me, God help me. Oh, please.
You figure out that he left her the money because she saved his life.
Mm.
Also because he didn't fucking have anybody else.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? And so he does say to her at that moment, which is a big clue. I can't remember the guy's name, but it was like this guy that he'd been in jail with, we find out later. But he said she would leave.
Yeah.
He was right. He said she would leave. So you're like, okay, this guy's been abandoned and he's so upset that he wants to kill himself. And right then it's like he never has a redeeming moment.
It's kind of hard to, we're not going to go through bit by bit every detail, but like the woman who's got his ball so twisted, he meets up with her, but he's hanging out with this other lady for a while.
Lily.
Lily. And Lily, she's a good girl. And it's kind of funny because they were rearing up to date. They were rearing up to be together, right?
Lily or Kitty?
Lily.
Same.
Yeah.
Huh? Like, you prefer Lily or Kitty?
Oh, no, Kitty.
Oh, I prefer Lily.
I mean, in terms of look, Kitty. I mean, Lily's...
Full package,
Lily's the one you take home. Ava Gardner is, like, the hottest lady we've seen all month.
Disagree.
Who's hotter?
I think she's beautiful.
No.
The one behind you, Rita Hayworth?
You know, Ava Gardner, we're really just going to be very superficial here. Ava Gardner has more ass than Rita Hayworth.
Okay, yes, Rita Hayworth does not have an ass, but I was thinking about face.
First of all, she's brunette, so that's automatically in my wheelhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And like, no offense to any, we've been looking at stunners all month long.
I know, I'm trying to think of who is the most stunning, the taxi driver.
And she was a brunette, right?
She was. I do prefer a brunette. But
she looked like someone. She looked like someone you would cast if you couldn't get Ava Gardner. That's who she looked like.
Ava Gardner is beautiful.
What about the lady from Kiss Me Deadly who probably cuts her own hair? That's the only one who's hotter. Who opened up the box and burnt up?
Oh,
the crazy lady.
No,
no, I'm kidding.
No,
but I am fascinated with that lady.
I'll come up with my favorite.
You can't. Because the answer is Ava Gardner.
Can I tell you, though?
I mean, the answer is whatever Gardner, you want it
well,
to
exactly.
be.
Exactly. It is my answer to the question. But Ava Gardner is beautiful. Can I recall her face? No. I think she's a beautiful woman who looks like beautiful woman.
I mean, I got some pictures up here, but she's crack-a-lacking.
All right.
I kind of get why old Swede would simp a bit.
Maybe I also just feel for Lily because she's smart.
Sure.
And she's good. And I'm so happy when we find out that she actually married the simp's old simp. You said simp. The Swede.
Either way,
old best friend who was a cop.
Yeah. And who ended up arresting the simp.
Yeah. That's the next place that we
because
go.
Because he took the fall for some shit that kid. Okay.
Okay. He asked Lily why, because Lily dated him, and he says, why did you break up? And Lily says, well, it's not very flattering, but I'll tell you the story. So they went to a party, and the second they walked in the room, Ava Gardner standing by the piano, and it was as though the Swede could no longer see Lily. She did not exist.
It's a nice apartment. It must cost a fortune to keep it up. I bet they need 2 servants at least to take care of it.
The more I know of love, the less I know.
Here's your drink, lady.
The more I give to
love. He said, here's your drink, lady.
Left the party and they were broken up.
Yeah, it was pretty rude.
It
truly.
Was so rude.
But yeah, he saw Ava Gardner over there, Kitty Collins, the character's name. You know, them dark-haired Irish girls, you got to watch out for them.
Okay.
You know? But yeah, he saw nothing else after that. And
you know what it is?
What?
I don't know if I've seen her in anything else, and I just don't like her in this movie.
Well, I guess she did a great job then.
She did a great job.
Because she is not a good person.
No, she's maybe the worst person in this movie.
And the Swede, his name is Ole Anderson.
Ole Anderson, like the wrestler.
Yeah, a wrestler. There's a wrestler named Ole Anderson. And I thought, like... Did the wrestler, and he wrestled with his brother Arn Anderson. They were original members of the Four Horsemen, and Ole Anderson actually passed away not too long ago, like I think within a month of this coming out.
Yeah.
And I was like, did he name himself after Burt Lancaster in the 46 killing? But the Andersons were from Minnesota. It's very Swedish, very Scandinavian up there. I think maybe...
just a name.
That name was not necessarily uncommon in that part of the country.
Makes sense.
And it was spelled Anderson in the movie.
Well.
But the Swedish simp is so simping that he takes a fall for some shit that Kitty stole while she's dating another guy.
Yeah, she's got some hot jewelry. And so hot as in stolen. And he's kind of separated from his friend who is the cop at the time. They've like kind of... split a little bit, not because the cop married Lily, but because they just have. And he's gonna, his friend is about to arrest Kitty. And that's when Pete, not Pete, Oli,
Simp Swede. Oli the Simp Swede.
Oh my God, it's so many names. He comes in and he's like,
come on, wait a minute. You don't understand. I swiped that stuff myself. I was letting him wear it, just for the night. I'm the one you're in. Get me? Try and get me.
Of course, we did get him the next day. He was trying to catch a bus to New York. I pleaded with him to tell the truth, but he stuck to his story. Got him 3 years.
And he punches his friend to let her get away, and he runs, and so the cop chases him, and he goes to jail for 3 years. And he's in jail with this sweet little man, and I know we don't need to talk about every single detail, but there's this little man that our insurance man also goes and visits and gets the story that they shared this.
He first sees him at Oli's funeral.
Yes,
and there's only like four people there.
And I think it's like Oli's old manager and Oli's old trainer.
Yeah.
And then, because he was a boxer. Yeah. And then this man who he was in prison with, and he goes and talks to him. And the guy is so sweet, and he knows all about the stars because that's what he learned in prison. He would just sit and look out the window. They had a window in their cell. And so he would talk about the sky all the time and the stars, and it was his thing. And he would tell
this guy's like Oli, the kid from Paris, Texas. He also just talked about the stars a lot.
That's true. Oli asked him when he was getting released to go check in on Kitty and let him know how she was doing. Well, he never followed up. But when Oli got out, he immediately, as they all do, as we know is never going to work well, immediately gets drawn into this gang who's going to do a heist.
Yes.
And that guy's there, but he backs out because he says, guys, listen, this is a big get, and I am not taking that chance. And they were like, but this is really low risk. And he goes, no. The bigger the get, the bigger the risk. He's like, I'm not saying I'm never going to steal again, but it's going to be such low stakes. I am not going back to jail.
And it was the smartest move because in the end, his simp Swede buddy would end up betraying him over this woman.
Yeah, but then even he lost everything, so it doesn't.
Which is like no one double, triple crosses in here.
Kitty so, until she doesn't.
He's so simping. Like, he went to prison for, like, I get, like, you look at Ava Gardner and you're like, holy shit, right?
Yeah.
But without any action, there ain't no devotion, you know, shit.
I know. He goes in this room and this guy Colfax is the ringleader.
Yeah.
Right? And he's already said that he gets, like, half the money and then everyone else gets to split up the rest of the money of this big robbery that they're going to do. And, again, it's like a payroll thing. I guess better than a bank, right? Because a bank is like ready to call the cops and probably has an officer and all that. And so it's another movie where we're having a payroll heist. But, you know, his friend who he was in prison with walks out and Oli needs to say no to this because he doesn't need to go back to jail either. But who's in the fucking room? Who's Colfax's girl? Fucking Kitty.
Kitty Collins.
And he sees her. And at first he's just talking to the guys and he's like kind of him and hawing. And then she from the shadows goes,
hello, sweet.
Hello.
I take it you know everybody?
Yeah.
Grab yourself a chair.
And then he's done.
There's one point in the movie where she's hungry, so she orders hot milk.
Yes, that's with the insurance agent in the future. Mm-hmm. She is a kitty who orders hot milk.
And there's always, and like, there's the golden harps represent being Irish or something?
Oh, so yeah. She gave him a scarf.
Yeah.
When they knew each other before he went to prison. It was this green scarf with these harps on it. And yeah, it is something about that, but he carried it forever. And when they go to do the heist, he wears it over his face as his disguise.
He's and such a simp.
The insurance guy, when he first sees that scarf in Oli's room after he's murdered, he asks the local guy, he's like, can I keep this? And they're like, sure, fine. Because he's like, he knows it's a clue, but he can't remember where he's seen this scarf before, but it's such a distinct scarf. But then what's weird is his boss, because, you know, all these insurance guys have a boss who wants them to get off the case and do their actual job. He says, you can buy these every St. Patrick's Day all over the place. And he's like, no, this is like real silk. This is like a real thing. And he runs with his guts because he says, if you don't let me keep doing this case, I'm going to quit. And the guy's like, you're so fucking good, I can't lose you because you'll run across the street and they will hire you.
Yeah, he manages to negotiate another week. And he probably doesn't even need that long.
No.
But come to find out, and who does he talk to where it finally reveals it? But Colfax, oh, he goes and talks to Colfax.
He goes and talks to Colfax. Colfax
appears to be turning straight. Like, he's like, oh, I got a regular life.
Yeah, I think he talks to Dum Dum before that. Because there's this other guy, Dum Dum, who finds him. Because basically what's happened is he's asking all these questions about Oli and the money and the heist that they did. And because he's asking all those questions, people think he knows where the money is. So Dum Dum has gone back to where Oli was killed, and the insurance guy is there, and they have this conversation where he gets the gun on Dum Dum, so Dum Dum has to talk, right? And he's the one that tells him, hey, listen, I didn't get shit. I want to know where the money is too, because I didn't get any money, because our boarding house we were supposed to go, I was told, Kitty came and told me it got burned up.
Yeah.
So we went to this barn, and then it was like Dum Dum and this guy named Blinky and Colfax. And he's like, we were all in the barn. Counting the money. And then all of a sudden, fucking Oli shows up and steals the money from them.
Yeah, he robs them. And
then runs off.
He goes and he's going to go meet with Kitty.
At the hotel. Where she then later left him, where he almost tried to kill himself.
That's where the lady saved him, who he ended up leaving his insurance policy.
Yes. And now the insurance man knows all of this, and he's like, okay, now I got to go talk to Colfax. So he goes, and I think Blinky had already gotten killed too. I think Blinky was not around. He was like a nervous guy.
Yeah.
And so he goes to Colfax, and Colfax has gone straight. Colfax is like a construction guy now.
Oh, yeah. It would appear that he has.
He obviously did not build his empire in a very straight way. So he is now this like construction magnate guy. And
Magnate?
Did I say magnet?
Yeah, he's a construction magnate.
Anyway. And so, you know, insurance guy's like, where is Kitty? Do you know where Kitty is? Because I know that you didn't get this. Like, I know the money got stolen from you. And Colfax is like, I have no idea where Kitty is. I'd like to know where Kitty is because I'd like to ask her a few questions. And he's kind of puts out the word that he wants to talk to Kitty. And so Kitty calls him, calls the insurance guy, and is like, okay, let's meet. This is when they sit down at a restaurant, and he orders, like, a steak sandwich rare, and she orders a
glass of milk, hot.
Milk.
She's hungry.
Hot milk.
So hot milk.
I haven't eaten all day.
Dish, and she licks it with her tongue like a kitty.
That doesn't happen.
Like an Irish kitty.
In your dreams, maybe. That doesn't happen. I don't know. Would that be sexy?
I guess I never thought about that. I mean,
I guess I was thinking in like Gardner a Catwoman kind of way. Ava Gardner's Catwoman would be hot.
I'll try to imagine it and see if I can pull one out to the thought later.
I don't want to know if it works, okay?
Okay.
So
I'll give you a play-by-play as it happens.
She sells him this story that she's moved away and she had to get on a plane to come see him because she was told that he was, you know, asking questions. And yes, she did take the money from Oli and ran away with it, but that she doesn't have it anymore. The max she could probably get him would be 65 or 70, but she has a life and a husband and children, and she just really needs to have this be done. You know, and then you look across the room and the two guys from the beginning, the hitmen, are there. And also Oli's old friend, who's the cop, who now has befriended the insurance man, he's also there. So she goes to powder her nose because all these ladies got to powder their noses all the time. And they don't piss, though. She definitely wasn't taking a shit.
She went to powder her nose and took the dough.
Something that happens. So, I mean, she'd be powdering her nose all over town.
Yeah.
But a shootout happens, and insurance guy and copper get to Colfax's house. Like, they get away, but they find out that she's climbed out the bathroom window. They get to Colfax's house, and then Colfax and Dum Dum have just had, like, a fatal shootout. Dum Dum's dead.
Yeah.
You know, Blinky was already dead. The Swede's dead. Mm. And there's Colfax, and Colfax is dying.
Yeah.
This is my favorite moment. Because Colfax is dying.
You love death.
No. I love these women's reactions to their man's being hurt or dead. Colfax finally admits it, or no, maybe he doesn't. Maybe the insurance man tells him, so he's dying. Well, then Kitty runs out, because Kitty is, guess whose wife? Colfax.
Colfax.
So she was lying through her teeth the whole time. So she stole the money from the Swede and took it to Colfax.
It's
and
a triple cross. It's like a quadruple cross.
Here. Yeah. We found out that
You got the Swede appearing to double cross the crew by robbing them. He goes to Kitty, who appears to be double crossing Colfax. Then Kitty takes off with the money, double crossing the Swede.
Mm-hmm.
But Kitty and Colfax were in on it the whole time.
They planned the whole thing.
So Colfax screwed, and Kitty actually screwed everybody.
Yeah.
You gotta admit how it's pretty clever, honestly.
Well, and the big clue, and I think why the insurance man knew that Kitty and Colfax were in cahoots, was because Kitty went about midnight to tell Blinky and Dum Dum that the boarding house burnt up. You gotta meet at the barn. Then at 12:30, she went to the Swede and she said, "Hey, listen, the boarding house has been burnt up. They're all going to meet over here. Colfax told me not to tell you. So you need to go steal that money."
Mm-hmm.
But then the insurance man finds out that the boarding house didn't burn until 3 a.m.
Mm.
Which means this was a scheme every bit of it, because the thing hadn't actually burnt. So they got their timing all wrong, and that seems like a very minor detail that would never come out, but it's dumb. But anyway, my favorite part is when her man is dying.
Yeah, this is good.
And she starts pulling at his collar, and she's saying,
"Jim, Jim, tell him I didn't know anything. Jim, listen to me. You can save me. Jim, do you hear me? Tell him I didn't know those gunmen were coming. Say, Kitty is innocent. I swear, Kitty is innocent. Say it, Jim. Say it. It'll save me if you do.
Don't ask a dying man to lie his soul into hell.
Kitty is innocent. I swear, Kitty is innocent."
He's dying! And there's no, "I love you. I'm going to miss you. I love you so much." She's yelling in his face as he's dying.
"It's no use, Kitty. Your would-be fall guy is dead.
Come back, Jim. Tell him. Come back. Save me. Jim, Kitty is innocent. I swear, Kitty is innocent. Kitty is innocent.
Well, he does it, and she gets locked up. Maybe even the gas
finally chamber. It's all her fault.
And that's the movie The Killers. And I like Burt Lancaster, his sad simp ass eyes. He did look like a sad man in this
he
movie.
Did look like a sad man.
But that's the movie. I'm not sure. I haven't watched the 64 version yet. It's supposed to be pretty good as well. Who's the main simp in that one, right?
Yeah, who plays the main character?
Lee Marvin.
Okay.
Was a Lee little Marvin. Older at the time. He might have been the insurance guy. I honestly don't know. But who was Colfax? Was it Ronald Reagan? I don't know.
When did it come out?
64, I believe. I think Cassavetes is in that movie. Are the character names just different?
Yeah, John Cassavetes' name is Johnny North.
That's what they call this. It's Cassavetes playing the Swede,
I guess. Lee Marvin is Charlie Strom. Angie Dickinson is Sheila. If this is the same movie, they just renamed everyone.
I think they're just renamed. My guess is that Cassavetes is playing the equivalent of the Swede.
Interesting.
They called him Johnny North. Okay. All right. Well, maybe not saying that's a bad movie. We haven't seen it, but it seems a little silly. But who? Maybe those are the original names. I don't know. Maybe they changed them on this one.
Lee Marvin is a professional killer.
Oh, he's probably Colfax.
Angie Dickens is Sheila Farr, Johnny's two-timing lover.
Yeah, so she's the Ava Gardner.
John Cassavetes is Johnny North, the man Charlie and Lee are hired to kill. So he is the Swede.
Yeah.
Ronald Reagan is Jack Browning, a gangster posing as a legitimate businessman. I think he's the one that's playing.
He's Colfax.
No, that's not Colfax. Dumb well, Dumb? No, remember the guy? It was Jack the Rack or something. Was hanging out with. That's a kind of a small character.
So we're going to give this 1 through 5 each, combined for best out of 10. And we'll see where it falls. What do you give the Robert Cidmac Killers The Killers from 1946. If you want to get a group of white people age 35 and up, just play that one Killer song. I've been out of my cage and I've been doing just fine. Obviously wasn't one of my bands, but yeah, they were fine, I guess. Anyway, what do you rate this movie?
3.5.
I think it's got the Gardner in it. It's got Ava Gardner in it. I'm going to give it a 3.75. So that is a 7.25. All right, folks, take a look at it. In the 7.25 realm, Robert Sidmack's The Killers shares the rankings with Deep Red, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, The Goonies, The Iron Claw, and Killer Clowns from Outer Space. It's at least as good as those movies, if not better. Check the show notes for links, other places to find us. Like, subscribe, leave a comment. We like stuff like that. Corrections, we appreciate things like that. Fun facts. Hit us with some... Assault our nuts with some fun facts.
Who do you think is the most beautiful femme fatale this month?
Yeah. You're not asking me, you're asking
No,
me.
I'm asking them. I don't know why I pointed like that, but you. You. What do you think?
Probably Ava Gardner.
I don't know. I'm looking back at the list, and there's been some beautiful ladies.
That'll do it for today. Supposing we get out of here.
Supposing we do.